This is your math gal, Julie Harland. Please visit my website at yourmathgal.com, where all of my videos are organized by topic. In this video, we're going to simplify the following expressions using the basic trig identities. These are the basic trig identities we might need to use. We've got the reciprocal identities, tangent and cotangent in terms of sine and cosine, the three Pythagorean identities, and the even and odd identities. So here's our first one. Now notice we already have things in terms of sine and cosine. But I do have a fraction. So my first thought is to get a common denominator. So let's try that. So I have a sine x over here, so I'm going to multiply this second fraction, the second term, by sine x over sine x. And that will give me, in the new numerator, cosine squared x plus sine squared x. Ooh, that should look very familiar to you. And in the denominator, I have the sine of x. Now the numerator is the basic identity, cosine squared x plus sine squared x equals 1. So we could replace that with 1. 1 over sine x. And then using the reciprocal identity, that is the cosecant of x. Now that's not the only way you could have done this problem, but that's the one that seemed most natural to me. Let's go on to the next one. All right, here we have cotangents and cosines. Oh, we have a fraction again. So we could begin by getting a common denominator, or I think I might want to first put things in terms of sines and cosines. I think either will work for this one. In fact, let's do it with getting a common denominator first. So I'm going to multiply this by cosine x over cosine x, and we'll see where it leads us. Sometimes you start somewhere and, you know, you make more of a mess out of it. In that case, it's better to start over again. But let's just begin by, and I'm sorry, I wanted to make this cosine squared to have a common denominator to see if that gets us anywhere at all. So that would give us cotangent squared x minus cosine squared x over the cosine squared x. And I can't think of any identity that involves both cotangent squared x and cosine squared x. So therefore, I'm thinking this isn't going to make it any easier. So here's an example. See where you start one way, and it kind of doesn't look like you're getting anywhere. Maybe I would if I kept going. So I'm going to go back to my first thought, which was to change the cotangent squared in terms of sines and cosines. So remember, cotangent squared is cosine squared over sine squared, right? So I could write that as cosine squared x over sine squared x, and that's all over the cosine squared x, and I still have this minus 1. So this is equal, right, at this point. Now, I'm going to multiply this by the reciprocal. This cosine squared x over sine squared x, and I'm going to multiply by that by the reciprocal of cosine squared x, so that's times 1 over. Remember, if you're dividing by cosine squared x, you are multiplying by 1 over cosine squared x. Then I have minus 1. Yep, this looks like I'm going to get something more interesting. My cosine squareds cancel, and that gives me 1 over sine squared x minus 1. Okay, well, what's 1 over sine squared x? We could do different things here, by the way. You might try to get a common denominator at this point. I'm going to just rewrite 1 over sine squared x as cosecant squared x minus 1, because sine is the reciprocal of cosecant. And is that an identity, or is this close to an identity? So I'm going to write what identity has the cosecant squared in it. Let's see, I think that is the cotangent squared x plus 1 equals the cosecant squared x. Okay, but I've got cosecant squared x minus 1, so check that out. If I subtracted 1 from both sides, that's the same thing as cosecant squared x minus 1. So you know what? This is actually the same thing as the cotangent squared. So the cosecant squared x minus 1 could be written as cotangent squared x. Now, if you didn't note that, you could replace cosecant squared x with cotangent squared x plus 1. So somebody else may have taken an extra step to do this. They could have written the cosecant squared x as 1 plus cotangent squared x. And when you subtract 1, you'll still end up at cotangent squared x. And so there you go. And you can see the different things that happen. When you start simplifying, you might start off on the wrong foot. And it's okay to just go back and start again. All right. And this is, again, just one way of doing it. Somebody else may have looked at this 1 over sine squared x minus 1 and, done something different. Let's see, like, what's a possibility. Somebody else may have said, oh, I'm going to get a common denominator and multiply it by sine squared x over sine squared x and see if this gets it anywhere. So this would give us 1 minus sine squared x in the numerator, and the denominator is sine squared x. And then 1 minus sine squared x is the same thing as cosine squared x. But cosine over sine is cotangent, so this is really cotangent squared x. And you get exactly the same answer. Now that I look at it, that looks like a little bit easier than that last one, the way I did it. So multiple ways of simplifying, but you do have to make sure you are using something that really is an identity anytime you replace something with something else. This is your math gal, Julie Harland. Please visit my website at yourmathgal.com, where all of my videos are organized by topic.